Culturecast.
Tis the season to shine with H&M. Discover the holiday collection and find fashionable pieces for your wardrobe or for under the tree. Get inspired and dazzle with this year's glam. From tuxedo styles, bow detailed pieces, impressive prints, and more. From unforgettable looks to unforgettable gifts. With fashion finds to home decor, find it all at H&M. Treat your loved ones and yourself this season. Shop in-store or at hm.com.
We are live.
We're live.
We are live. Let's see. Are we?
Yep.
We are.
We are.
Oh, we are. Look
and
at
now
that.
We're going to go IGTV live.
Oh, my goodness.
Here?
Yeah, move to the right. There we go. Live. There you go.
There we go.
There you go.
Okay.
Oh. We are now live.
We're live.
Wait. No, wait. This is a different one. Oh, no, no. Click the cancel one.
Okay.
You have to start it all over again.
Wait, can I just...
No. Click that because it's using the picture. Yeah. Enter and then we start again. Hello. Welcome. Welcome to Abracadabra. Create what you speak. Let me get my swaggy hair on here.
We're live. Wait, why isn't it going live?
Because it's using the same picture.
No, there.
It's using the same picture.
Wait, so from
click the X on the top.
I did.
Oh, okay. Let's see. Cancel that. Click the X to end the live.
I did.
Just click end the live.
I did.
Okay. Delete video.
I did.
Let's do that. Now click on the top plus top.
I did right here.
No, wait. Hold on.
And then...
Go to live. Okay, hold on. Where's the picture? I don't see the picture. Click the X again. Click on the top. Where there is plus on the top. On the top. There you go. Now on the bottom, scroll to the live.
Oh.
Another one. Now you go.
Do I do the story?
No. Oh, yeah. You could do that. We are in the...
No. We're live.
No, this will cause a headache. This is like we're stone and we don't even smoke anything.
Where is the one you found?
One more. More. Go more to the left. More to the left. No, that the other way.
To the right?
Yeah. Another one. Anyway, just do the regular.
Okay.
Just do the regular. We're letting them here hang with the... Well.
Hello.
Well.
Now we're live on IGTV.
And Facebook. And YouTube. And I got some itching going on.
Yeah.
Welcome to Abracadabra, Create What You Speak. It's an empowerment program. I'm Ilan Azulay, spiritual mentor and a sound therapist for you who are ready to reclaim your power. Gina Ann. Hello, Gina.
Hi, good morning.
Inner child specialist.
That's right. And happy Halloween.
Happy Halloween.
We're tapping into our inner child of dressing up.
Inner child of, yeah, just like being on the loose. Kind of,
that's
you
right.
Know, this is really kind of like...
I know, I was going to wear the wig, but it looked better on him.
I don't know. Do you think?
Yeah, it looks great.
I don't know. I think I'm going to. I have a thing with the hair. When I grew up, I all the time had this afro hair. You know.
Yeah.
No, seriously, I had this afro hair, and
it looks great.
And
like I said, going back to our childhood.
And so you know, it's like in Israel, for example, we don't have Halloween.
Right.
We have Purim, and Purim is. I just want to see how are we.
Well, tell them where we're at. Right
well. Now. So in Purim, we dress up for a different reason, for a holiday reason that happened in Judaism. But we are on the road. We are still And maybe we'll continue to be on the road, you know, it's like...
I like being on the road.
I like being in the... Now we are in the tent in my backyard. We have a tent.
Yeah, we have a tent. Or he has a tent.
And we're here. So this is our... This is like the Moroccan tent, yeah. You know. We got some coffee, although not Moroccan coffee. And
what is your inner child saying today of how you're dressed? What is your inner child saying today? What is your... Hi, Ali. Hi, Elizabeth.
My inner child. Well, you know, at first I started wearing the galabia, which is from, it's like a Moroccan thing. Like at that time they wore this kind of, well, still they wear this kind of long dresses, one piece clothes. Very easy, actually. Just lift them. Yeah.
Lift and go.
Lift and go.
Kind of like a kilt. But you're wearing pants.
Well, I'm wearing pants.
Do they normally wear a pant?
No, it depends.
Just depends.
It just depends.
Probably in this kind of scenario, it's best because we're seated.
Yeah. Yes. Especially if we don't go commando. Anyway, so.
Well. What's your inner child saying?
Oh,
today?
My inner child. So it was like, it started with this, and I was like, you know what? I don't really connect to that old tradition thing of where, you know, I mean, I connect to it, but not in a sense of that's what I want to be when I grow up kind of thing.
Right.
You know, but this is.
I'm telling you.
This is.
I knew it wasn't for me when I brought it.
No,
I knew it fits you.
I'm cool with the hair. So. I connect because when I was young, I was like, I had this afro.
Well, you look like a rocker. See? And he does play the guitar. So today I'm a gypsy and a fortune teller, which is right apropos of what I do.
Apropos.
So I love dressing up. What I loved about Halloween was dressing up. When I was a child, we didn't have all these elaborate costumes. So we'd be, I was always a gypsy or a hobo, or my mom did make a Batgirl costume once. But, you know, as I got older, that's what I loved about Halloween. Yes, the candy. I love candy. But, dressing up was the most fun because it is. This is where your inner child can come out and have fun.
Yeah. You know, this is you're talking about what your mom dressed you up as. Mm-hmm. And here's I have a traumatic experience to share. All right, I have a traumatic experience to share. Now we're smiling, right? Isn't it funny?
Sorry, I have to fix your bangs.
Fix my hair, darling.
There you go.
All right, thank you. You know, with all this much hair, you know, I got to pay attention to other stuff.
And like this.
Oh, see? I love doing this all the time.
Look at that, see?
Yeah.
See, it's girls.
Yeah, it's like, oof, man.
It's okay, I won't put your hair in a rubber band, though.
Okay.
Yet.
So, I have to share a traumatic experience.
Okay.
I think I told you that, but
it's okay. It'll be like hearing it for the first time.
Yeah, you know, that's the thing of Alzheimer's. You know, it's all the time exciting from the beginning. Right.
Exactly.
Anyway, so I was about 8 or 9 or something like that, and it was Purim, and the camera is here.
Oh.
And it was Purim, and Purim is the holiday where we dress up to be anything that we are not usually, like mm-hmm. just to be something different, right? A day where you can be somebody different. And what's the thing is that day, most of the time, we are what we most want to be. On that holiday day, think about this. This is interesting.
I really want to be a hobo, but I love.
No, but it's but there is an asp. No, no, listen. The hobo mobo, but there is an asp.
Hobo mobo Jojo.
Oh, hobo.
Ho-ho. Ho-ho and the hobo, and that's in my next book.
So, no, but there is an aspect. There is an aspect. Like, thank you, darling. Thank you. But there is an aspect. In that hobo-ness, that there is something, maybe the freedom to not be, you know, to whatever, something that is
no
there.
Worries, you hit it.
There is an aspect in that character that we are dressed up as. Me with my hair. To me, it's like this.
If I would have kept making only the minimum payments on my credit cards, my debt would have taken me 47 years to pay off.
These are real National Debt Relief customers.
I knew I wasn't going to be able to get out of debt by myself.
Credit card, medical, or personal loan debt? National Debt Relief negotiates with your creditors to reduce what you owe.
National Debt Relief got me out of debt.
You could be debt-free in as little as 24 to 48 months. Visit NationalDebtRelief.com to learn more and get started. NationalDebtRelief.com.
first it has to tie with music, because I come with studied music and since I was a kid. But it's also this, I don't know, this, there is some freedom in it.
It is, and it puts you in what I call the role, right? Like, when you put the costume on, it's like all of a sudden it embodies you. That's why I love acting.
Yeah, it's like,
you know, you embody the character that you're in, and that's the inner child.
So that inner child, I believe, is that part that is that part that you really connect to, that you really connect to in a costume. So what in a costume do you really connect to, and why? And if we all figure that out, I mean, hey, maybe we can get rid of the costumes and just be us every day.
Well, instead of wearing the masks, right?
Instead of wearing the masks.
Whatever the mask may do, we all wear masks. But that's one of the things why I love the work that I do, because I'm an inner child specialist. So it's tapping into not the surface of the mask. Yeah, the mask is what is revealed, but underneath it is getting to what I call the umbilical cord.
Yeah.
And so you don't have to wear the mask. Yes, dressing up is fun. That's part of it. But this is symbolic of why we did it today. It's not about Halloween or pyramids.
Of course not. Of course not. No. Yeah. It's to bring you a message to go with you through an experience, you know? To go, you know, when we're talking outside of the program, it's different than when we talk in the program, because we have a new level of connection, of understanding. It's interesting. Right. But in a costume, we connect to this place. Right, I think it's a good exercise. You know, it's a good look to what part in that costume you connect to, and why? What does it make you
what
feel?
What do you connect with? Like when you tried on the wig, you didn't have the wig before I got here. So when you put the wig on, did it change the entire feeling?
Totally. Now I'm putting it to words, right? Because it was feeling.
What was the feeling first?
It was freedom. I was like freedom. I was like. Oh, I remember when I was, I didn't even tell finish the first trauma. I'm going to the next trauma.
See, getting to the umbilical cord.
But let me finish the first one. Okay. The first one was, I was 8 or 9 and my mom used to sew all my costumes. So in the beginning, I had like all the Superman and everything. She sewed by hand, like everything by hand. But then one Purim, she wanted me to dress up as My Fair Lady. An 8 or 9 or 10 year old kid with a My Fair Lady, I had this big blonde wig, you know, big blonde wig, this dress with the shushu, whatever you call it.
Ruffles,
the white.
Yeah, the white.
Like you get married in.
Oh, like a wedding dress.
Like a wedding dress. Okay. Probably it was hers when she was 12.
Yeah, maybe.
You know, because she got married 12, you know. And this, all right, so makeup and everything. But the only thing I think that gave it away, because when we were walking down the streets and I was working with her, people would say, oh, what a sweet girl. Like literally.
Well, because your eyes. Yeah,
I had long eyelashes. But you know what gave it in? My work boots.
So did you want to be that or not?
No, I hated that.
Okay, and so you didn't really have a say.
Well, yeah. No, here's the thing. When somebody is... When you're born, let's take the extreme, when you're born into bondage, you don't know that you have another option.
True.
Okay, so so the way that I grew up yes, there was a rebellious part in me, but it was only to a certain extent, at least at that age.
Yeah. You know? No, it's really interesting. We couldn't afford a lot of costumes, the intricate costumes, but it wasn't even about affordability. I grew up in Texas, in Aledo, Texas. And so again, a gypsy was easy. I love being a gypsy, though. I really felt that even now. I like being a gypsy.
It fills you.
It's
it fills
in my next. A gypsy and a hobo. Gypsy is not anything. And a hobo is not a homeless. A hobo is someone that hops the freight trains to look for work.
You've done that too.
I've done that too. I've hopped a freight train. Absolutely.
And you were like 3 days. How many days?
3 days. 3 days from Van Nuys to Ojai. Yeah.
Trains off Van Nuys. She owes you money.
Yeah, exactly.
She owes you tickets.
No, I was following Mark Twain, right? I was a teacher at the time. So, but this is
and
what
the teacher.
Yeah, this is what I love about the costumes, right? Because you do embody. This is what I love about acting. It gets you in touch with the emotions of what you're feeling in the moment. And so when there is trauma, like you said, we would go back to that moment. How did that moment make you feel when you had to dress up as My Fair Lady? Did you want to be something else?
I don't remember this moment, at this point. I think I wanted anything else but that. But here's the thing, you know, it's like, but I have one picture of it, you know, and it's interesting because if I look now at everything that, everything that transpired in my life and how things turn out, you know, it's my path. It was my path. You know, the reason I'm here is because I'm not there, you know?
Oh, that's a good line. It's like, say that again.
The reason I'm here is because I'm not over there, right? I'm not there. I'm here. And that's a good reason enough. Because.
But you came from there to be here.
But now, we're talking about now, right? We're talking about the now, right, all the time, yeah. Right? Okay, so now we're here. But everything that happened before that prepared me for where I am now, mm-hmm. You know? So, you know, we can look at traumas and we can say, you know, how was this good for me? How was this good that somebody got mugged or got, you know, sexually abused or beaten up or whatever? If we come out of this emotional, if we come out, I want to finish this line before I look at that. If we come out of that emotional attachment and just look at it like a map and say, like a map without any emotions, because truth has no emotions. Truth is as it is what it is, right? Everything else is what we attach to. So we come out of the emotions, we'll see that also this was in the path of the person. Also, this was in the path of the person that at this point, yes, in physicality, suffered a loss or pain or that kind of thing, or things that I know that I've gone through, but I also understood that I needed to go through it while I was going through it.
Right. But the costume representing of who we are, like my son always wanted to be Batman and Superman.
That represents an aspect of what your son wants.
What exactly. Right? Yeah. So a gypsy, I wanted that freedom to be me.
Yeah.
A hobo, I wanted to go, oh, my cousin Diana's on. Hi, Diana. Chinky. Chinky, happy Halloween-y. So I do feel costumes that we choose are representative of what we want. So I think what that's a really good point. So that's the inner child. And we all have the inner child.
Exactly. We all have that.
And we do. When you put on a costume, you put on makeup. It's like women, right? Or men. We're at home. Our hair
are
is
Are you hinting on something?
Oh, so beautiful.
Oh, fixing it.
So, but when we go out, us women, like we dress up, we put our, we embody that. Right? It makes us feel good.
Yeah, yeah, that's right. Now, the question is, we can go on forever. The question is, do you feel good because you're already used to and brought up in a social acceptance, a social stigma that this is how it's supposed to be? Just like girls that believe, that dream from the 13 to get married, but they really don't care who. They just want to get married at 20 because that's what they've been brought into, that life and that social construct and familial construct sometimes. You know, I'm not saying, but we can go into it
forever.
I'm not
making it heavy. You know? No, for me, it's light.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
For what costumes and putting on makeup is light. It's
fun. I'm thinking like a woman. I go like...
I'm thinking like I'm just dressing because it's fun.
No, it's fun. It's fun. But it's fun. For me, the fun is to understand why, too.
Sure. And for me, that's the fun. But when I have my Girl Scouts, I would take them to Sephora. They were like literally 9-10 years old. And they would like flood themselves with makeup. And we would walk out.
Julie asks, are you sure two of you are in costume?
No, not at all. We're in costume. This is who we are.
Exactly.
That's why I said I'm a gypsy. I'm a fortune teller.
That is the thing.
That's why we chose these questions.
So the question comes to kind of rolls into what I wanted to talk about, and to just like, you know, play around with it, because it's really about play. It's really understanding things, and like you are beautifully saying that, you know, everything has to be with play, because if it's no play, there's no fun, and there is no really lightness. You know, being spiritual doesn't have to be heavy. Mm-hmm. Unless I pour of you some of this thing.
The medicine. See, it's spiritual psychedelic. No, it is about play.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter how old you are. I have a saying in my house. It says, you don't grow old. I think you took a picture of it. You grow old when you stop playing.
Exactly.
And when we stop playing, it does. We can play till the end of our breaths. You know, and for me, this is playing today. It's not about Halloween and Purim or anything. Yes, it's about Halloween and Purim. What you said about spirituality, you know, play, spirituality is a science. Spirituality for me is not just a label, it's a state of being. Play is a state of being. You can go out and try to organize play, but play sometimes is in the simplest of laughter. And it is like you're in a wig. It's funny, but there's actually
it
something
is in it. There is something, you know, it's like in every situation, it's like, what is the opportunity? Now, and what is this representing? I mean, what can are we not spiritual now? I mean, I totally disagree with that. Did I ask the question?
What do you mean you disagree?
I disagree that we're not. I disagree that we're not that being in play is not spiritual.
Oh, exactly. Yeah.
You know, it is. You know, And here's the thing, and it's humor. And when we say play, it's humor, you know, among whatever it is. Oh, like that.
Humor and human. Oh, you have a mustache too.
Humor and.
Humor.
Humor, well, and
humor,
human.
And human.
Humor.
Well, you know what Hugh is. Hugh means whatever the derivative, right? The Latin.
So humor and.
So you want a double mustache?
No, oh. Human and human.
No,
and,
you're. Here.
Yeah, I was trying to, you know. Double mustache because of this.
Yeah. God, I didn't get you a blonde wig.
Yeah, you did. I think there's some. Oh, there's
some
a blonde hair.
Highlights.
There's a blonde hair.
No, but this is the point. You know, I love that. Spirituality, they think it's no religious connotation either.
No.
It's a state of being. It's a state of play. It's a state of.
Exactly.
You know, like a crystal. What's a crystal? Sometimes it means different things for everyone.
So that's right. By the way, if you are just joining us, we are at my tent here. Yes. Something said somebody? Oh, somebody.
Julie?
Yeah.
Perfect.
We were there. Yeah, so we're at the tent. We're on the road, abracadabra, since we I'm kind of okay that we moved around.
I like being on
the
road.
I kind of remember moving around.
I'm a gypsy,
you know?
So being on the road is thing.
But you just today brought the gypsy today. So the gypsy starts from today. Didn't you mention it in the programs, other programs, that you're a gypsy?
No, but I like being on the road.
Okay,
I like
that's the thing. Yeah, we are on the road, and so now we are in the tent. It's not a far road. It was a short road drive from the studio to the tent.
And
it's a short walk, and I like it. I think this is.
It
tell us what you
vibe.
Think. I like this place.
Yeah, tell us what you think. And I'd like to know what some of your favorite costumes. I teach a class of fairy tales, which JoJo
is. Oh, yeah,
the
one that you started in the school,
in
right?
Manhattan
yeah.
Beach and public speaking debate.
Yeah, that's
and
cool.
I asked them, you know, I said, what was your favorite Halloween costume and what is your favorite Halloween costume? It was really interesting.
What
to
was
hear.
And what is?
Yes.
Oh, really?
And so, you know, they're only 5 and 7 years old, but they're very evolved and very. Very evolved children.
Oh, wow.
And then I even asked them, what's your superpower now? And what would you like your superpower to be? Me, I picked the simple. I want to be invisible, which I would. I would like to be invisible. And I can float everywhere. So,
but you know,
hi, Miss Hagman. Hi, Tara.
You know, I can't wear anything.
So, yeah, well, you can't wear anything. Who cares? Okay. Then we're free. We go back to the birthday suit.
Exactly.
The childhood, the inner
yeah.
child. And some of them said such
yes.
fascinating things. They wanted to teleport. They wanted to
wow.
shapeshift. I was like, they wanted to have all the superpowers. They wanted to be ice and turn things into. It was fascinating.
There's nothing to do with the old stuff like
right.
Alice in Moomooland and all
Moomooland,
this kind of stuff.
Yeah. No, it was very, very
oh, wow.
much evolved. Which the children are like, they are a golden ticket, so to speak. They are the ones that
well,
are
the new
leading us.
The new generation that was born after the 90s, they're all evolved. You know, all that we've worked for all these years, they're already born with it in them, their understanding, their way of looking at things, also if it's all computers, but their way of connecting, the way of understanding these very complex.
That's right. We don't have to say it's spiritual. You
no.
don't have to say the word.
You know, it's like we're talking about the kids of today. Like you're mm-hmm. saying, oh, their gifts were to teleport, or that's what they wanted. It's like, can you imagine an evolved a generation trick-or-treating. Can I have a gluten-free, please?
Oh, exactly.
Can I have sugar-free?
Exactly.
Can I have a non-GMO?
Exactly.
And this woman.
That's a great... We hate it when we got pencils.
Yeah, I was like, give me the... No, but yeah. you know, to that, this generation, they want GMO,
right.
non-GMO,
right.
earthly-friendly, green. Was this candy made in China? You know, this kind of stuff.
Well, you know what's interesting about candy? I can never eat... a Kit Kat again. Let me tell you why. My daughter.
Why?
Okay. So my daughter came over. My daughter's 23 and my son is 26. Christopher and Megan, my babies. So Megan came over and we had a nice dinner and everything. And then she bought some Kit Kats, which I love candy, Kit Kats. So I had one and I'm like, oh no, Megan, it's good. She ate the whole bag. So 2 a.m. she comes. Oh, okay. She had projectile around 3:30 in the morning. It was Kit Kat. I can never eat a Kit Kat again.
What would she do?
She got sick on the Kit Kat. She ate a whole bag of Kit Kats.
What would she do?
She puked. She projectile puked.
Like, ah.
Like
no, you don't want to get you to do it. You don't want you to do get you to do it.
I know.
Again,
like,
right?
Okay. See, I'm so gullible.
It's okay.
Like a massage, right, Julie? Like a massage. This little girl, she'll, oh my gosh. So this little girl, and I'm like, we can, and I love Kit-Kats. I'm like, thank you, Megan. I'm going to switch back to Heath Bar. But why would I bring this up? I don't know why I brought it. It doesn't matter. Well, it's gullible. About candy. Oh, when you said gluten-free.
Yeah, yeah, gluten-free, gluten-free.
So we can never eat Kit-Kats again. This poor little girl.
I like Kit-Kat, you know.
I can't eat it again.
So let's go. So I want to go back to, we were talking about the inner child. The inner child is really, you know, in a costume, we're dressing up as what we want to be, or something that there is something that we identify with. So it kind of brings me to this topic of our journey predestined? Is our journey pre-selected, or is our journey conceived?
You mean, like, do we have this soul contract that we're designed, even though we have free will?
Exactly. We have a soul contract. A soul contract.
This is interesting. Go ahead.
No, right? Here's the thing, that our soul is cumulative. Our memory is recitative, so to speak. It's like when we go through the experiences, when we're talking about past lives, right? We're talking about past lives and we recognize certain things and we've been there and we understand and there are certain people that have a higher degree of understanding because their soul is more advanced, and some people are...
They've learned their lessons,
right? So when we are here and we have a soul contract, that has to do, for example, with money, okay? We have something, or soul contract with the person about certain things. When we come here, our soul is being elevated by learning the lesson, right? By actually learning the lesson and shifting the perception.
That's the hope and faith of it, right? So how about somebody who is doing life in prison for an unconscionable violent act? Was that his soul contract?
That's a good point. You know, that's a good question. You know, this question is many times asked by, you know, when the person experiences that, they ask that. They ask for that. We choose our journey when we come here.
See, this is where I'm a little hazy. This is where, yeah, I love your point of view. There's no right or wrong.
The question is, what hazy are you about? Are you hazy about the fact that this is a possibility, or are you hazy about the fact that this is a possibility?
You mean I'm looking at it from an emotional standpoint, yeah, rather than
are you?
I think I'm looking at it at a logical and an emotional, and my life experiences here.
Mm-hmm.
That I've incurred so far. I think wrapping my brain around it, because I get emotional. I'm sensitive to the fact of, like, watching another person suffer. Did we really choose to do that in this lifetime? I think it could be emotional. You're probably absolutely right. It's just, I have a very difficult wrapping my logical brain around, because my heart feels like a child, you know,
so
here's suffering, or a person suffering, yeah. And yes, we've all suffered. We're all going through things, and that we asked for this. I don't know.
So here's the thing. Also, the fact that you are emotional about it, because it's natural to see somebody is suffering. This is where we connect. This is where you and that person connect, because you experiencing the pain and the suffering of that person, you are going by yourself on your own lesson that you had to experience, and that person is your connector. The same way, the other way around.
Mm-hmm.
By him seeing you, we don't know what that, because you've told me situations, stories about when you were working with the court system.
Yes.
You told me about stories, you know, and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And you told me about situations where certain people saw you. You know, that could have also caused within them a certain movement. This is where all the circles, where we're all connected. It's all connected to one another. And so my experience, by you and me sitting here, you know, I have what to learn from this, and I'm going through this experience, even if we're talking about this, the inner child, and going through all these things. And so do you. We may be conscious of it, we may not. The fact of the matter is that it's happening. And so when the person, you're talking about the person that sits in jail, and was, did he have a choice when he, again, I'm not going to a specific thing. I'm not.
No, it's hypothetical.
It's hypothetical. It's, but, of course. But there are many details to the story, but the story is just a story, right? So, but he made a choice to do that. Yes, he made a choice. The free will that we have is all the time in the intersection, not after we chose the path.
It's like a fork in the road. Which way do you go, left or right?
That's right.
Or the middle.
So once I go, once, well, that.
A fork is three prongs. So.
American fork.
Is there a two fork?
Oh, of course. You know the thing with the chicken where you take the big one to stick the chicken in?
Oh, the piercing. Okay, I can't even hear that. See, him just saying piercing
so,
the chicken.
So I don't know. I mean, I think
see you're, the pain? I mean, I can't, because I visualize it and then I feel the in my stomach. So,
so
I think,
like,
I'm that empathicism. Which, oh, my brother, okay. Michael, might be on. Hi, Michael. He says I didn't address him last time, so I'm addressing my
hello,
brother,
Miguel.
Michael.
So. Oh, no, but you,
oh, look, wait.
We have to
I'm
look
looking
here.
At there. Sorry.
Look
I'm
here.
Technology. Yeah. So thank you to everyone joining on IGTV. I am paying attention. If you have a question or comment, please. We're both eyeballing
thank
it,
you for being so. Here, abracadabra. We yeah. are creating what we're speaking, actually.
Well, I
you
learned
know?
Something from you before that I was conscious, but maybe not fully conscious of. I tend to, when I get an emotional state, I... like you called it ping pong back dialogue. It's not being argumentative or anything, but it can come across that way. It's because I get nervous. I don't want the confrontation or the hurt
yeah.
of someone else.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, it's like somebody asking me for my number and I don't want to give it, but I don't want to hurt their feelings.
But that's, but,
and I'm
yeah.
like, where is that in me where I can't, now I feel if I felt I was threatened or my life or my, I, it's not a matter of that. It's just, I don't want to.
It's not about, it's taking on you everything else. It's taking on you everything else, and it is, and you are okay to, you know, you're being told, so you're giving that. But because you're also doing what you're doing, you know, maybe there is a way of harnessing your gift, your power, so it doesn't spill out and attract those that are.
Well, I think yeah. I'm always going to attract people who seek some sort of guidance because it's who I am.
You are. But there is, but there is
to
a
give
way.
My number. I'm like, oh, maybe he needs assistance in something as well.
No, but you know the thing. You know, I told you this. I think, you know, it's something that I also recognize.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, it's like sometimes we see that fire, that flame. You know, it's like here, like the mic, right?
Yeah. I'm like, right?
It's the microphone
again.
Right?
No, I like to get close to the fire because
exactly.
it's delving into the psychological, emotional, and physiological.
It's exciting.
Curiosity.
It's exciting physically.
I don't want
right?
anyone hurt, but
no,
I'm
but
like,
still, but the
I
fact,
like getting close. I like the zany.
But the fact
I attract
is,
the zany.
No, I get it. But the fact is, you cross the line, and then you want to retract, and then what's creating? That's creating the other side to.
Could be, but that's their story, not mine.
No, but there is an instigator. There is always a cause and effect, right? There you do something, there is an effect to that. There is an effect to that. What you did, right? It's like you're talking about the 20 years guy. There is an effect to that. There is a cause and there is effect, and this is what we're. This is part also of the duality, as I see that.
Right.
It's like there is we do A and we're B. Why are we not there? Because we're here. You know, why is black? Why is white? You know, it's like, if it's not here. So there is always this play.
Push-pull.
This push-pull, this ping-pong, right? Right?
Yeah.
It's like all this is like a push-pull. And we're always being the push-pull. The thing with the number is, I think that there is definitely is, you are just good by default. You're so kind, you're so good. And this is something that many... find it when you are so good and so kind, and because there is so much also pull from the other side, then there are those who will answer the call, right? But then, like when you say this is me,
we just
right?
had a deja vu.
Yeah, we've been here before.
Oof.
So just like you're saying, what you're saying, that you want to give the number or whatever, you want to help somebody, or oh, maybe he's this, maybe he's that. Do you think that this is your person, you who you are, or is this responding and being part of a predator lane or a trail, part of a wound or a pattern?
I think it could be both.
Okay.
I think it's a blend. Recognizing, and this is great, recognizing your pattern or
exactly.
when you're conscious of something that doesn't sit right, that's your intuition. We all have intuition. It's a perfect opportunity to to feel it. So I always say pain, whether it's emotional, physical, mental, is an alert for our body to heal it. So yeah. I think this coming up in this situation was like, oh, this is an opportunity for me to recognize. And this, when I recognize it and you allowed me to, you didn't shush it down. I'm like, wait, let's talk about it. Yeah. What that means. Yeah. Where is this coming from? Without me getting defensive or getting my feelings hurt. I'm like, oh, this will be an opportunity so I can heal this part of me. Why did I feel I had to give it to him? Why did I feel that? Why do I feel like I have to help everybody? That's not doing me a service even. So it'll allow me to help others. You know, I don't sometimes follow my own.
Maybe there was some kind of an inner fear or threat from that person. Maybe there was some kind of like.
I didn't feel any threat. I just felt I didn't want to. He asked and he was sweet and he was kind and, you know, this is what I do. And he was very excited about his work.
I can imagine.
Very excited about his work. He said he's an artist in that. And I gave him a tool. Sometimes it's hard for me not to read. And so I think he appreciated that. And I think that was part. There are always this duality of I'm a woman, but also I'm very kind, maternal.
Yeah.
So there's this duality that I felt within him as I, in retrospect, I recognize and I'm like, yes, I'm part of that or cause of that.
Yeah.
So anyway, we learned something just literally 3 minutes before we went live.
And I'm that's right.
I wanted to address it now that's because it was still laying heavily on me and I think it could assist other people. And so thank you for that. I think I'm always constantly learning with every person that
this is how we do. When we come together, there is always an opportunity. We can always choose to, hey, see what's going on. Or we can be in this emotional state. We say, why do you do this to me? Instead of just looking at something just as a map, just like, oh, is it possible that giving, for example, the number or feeling the way that you felt.
No, I can take it
seriously. Giving the number, giving the number maybe comes from a place of that fear of that.
I'm going to pull it back to, was that in my soul contract to give my number because I had to learn from that?
No. That is something else. That I think is that there are cause and effect, right? Mm-hmm. So let's say, so you are here to learn, for example, about love. Okay. Now we can say it, oh, it's very generic, but yes.
I was.
It is. And it is. And it is to learn
Till
about
21.
Love, you know, it is to learn about love. And again, we can go into this.
And what's love?
No, we can go into this whole thing. What I can say about this is that the Torah is love. Water is love. The Torah has 70 faces, 70 faces to every, by the way, every situation, every subject has 70 opinions about it more. No more than 70 opinions. And so for love has 70 faces.
Yeah.
And so there are so many ways and so many faces to love and to express love and to be in that space of love and to be in love and to be in this place of gratitude and understanding and accepting of the other person. It doesn't mean that if I'm in this space, I can be... So I'm not in that space. If I love somebody in a certain way, I don't love somebody in a different way. This is different ways. So for example, you are here. So now all the rivers, right, lead to the same ocean. So all that you're experiencing from that place, from that energetic space of that which you need to learn from or about. So for example, if it is love that you are here to learn about, or money, or whatever, and what is in love? Right, relationship. And it's not only the relationship between me and you, it's between me and me. Then there is you, and then there is my relationship to this. Like, how is this going on?
The relationship
like, the relationship between you, the two people or three people, that relationship. It's the relation between the two. And so the actions that are being done, let's say somebody, the action that somebody did. The action that somebody did or somebody said, you said like, oh, did I need to learn this? This is all in that same path. This is all because you're talking about love into yourself, into recognizing that, so what if somebody said, come here? Does that mean that you have to come here?
No, that's what I'm saying. So that's why we're talking about soul contract and what we feel. Just like we're in costume, right? We're kind of, it's fun. It's playful. Oh, hi, Danya. She's from Alito, Texas, too.
Yeah. Hello.
We're having a conversation. It's almost like your costume disappears because I'm seeing the soul essence of you. Yeah. Now, I know I'm going off track, but it's all about the soul essence. So I do believe we come in this world to learn a lesson. Now, whether you believe that we keep going or we stop and we go, you know, heaven and hell, I don't know. I don't know.
You're mixing many things here.
That's
you're
what
mixing
I'm saying.
Many things here.
Well, that's what a costume is.
I don't know, though, when you said heaven and hell, that triggered me because that is a dogmatic representation.
That's right.
Of
it's a religious.
Of what
but
is.
that's not what I believe or not believe. It's what some people believe. That's when we're talking about soul contract and past lives.
So when we come together, you know, people that you have strong contact with, people that you feel, you know, how many times you meet somebody and said, you know what, feels so familiar, mm-hmm. right? Feels so familiar. You know, 99.97.
6-3 I was like trying to figure it out. Well, you said something interesting about love.
Is that we are connected, and probably from the same also spiritual tribe, you know, and so the saying of the world is a stage and we are all actors. It's totally is not just literal. It's figuratively and literally speaking, because. You know, in another lifetime, it could have been my sister, you know, okay. You know, and it's like somebody else, and it could be male or female. And so when I was talking about the soul remembers, the soul is cumulative. We're going through these experiences and our soul remembers. And that's a whole different story. I don't want to go into something. Soul remembers. But then when we come here every time, our mind is getting reset. It's like rediscovering the essence. And by rediscovering the essence, we are going through the experiences of which we need to learn from.
So if we don't learn the lesson, then we repeat it in the next life.
We repeat it. It's a completion because if you don't complete a puzzle, I'll come back to it later.
Okay, so let's say
Right? Sure. I don't complete a puzzle. I'll put it in the wrong piece. Or put it in the wrong piece. Exactly.
Right? Have you never and you try to make it fit, right?
Or you know what is putting in the wrong piece, for example, you know, is that wrong also?
Exactly.
Exactly. So
exactly. Is it wrong because the piece doesn't fit exactly in the puzzle?
You know, the thing is
it's like coloring out of the lines. Go ahead and color out of the lines.
Exactly.
Tell the children. You don't have to color in lines. If you want to color out of the lines or you want your pumpkin to have five eyes, it's okay. So you were talking about dogma, right?
Yeah, right.
That's really interesting because children are, you know, when they would teach art at your fingertips, it has to look exactly like something.
Even the kids that you were teaching, they thought that the children wanted you to teach them about Alice in Fartland or whatever.
Yeah, and which is fine. But so I taught, you know, they want a certain mechanism of, and I respect that, you know, Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. I didn't want to talk about the evil or the, how about let's talk about sneezy, dopey, grumpy, and let's act out the emotions.
There we go. Yeah, that's cool.
Let's act
out
the emotions of what's sneezy and grumpy and what does dopey mean? Like, you know, they wanted me to even eliminate dopey. Why? What does dopey represent? You know, for me, it's about the children. We shortchange them.
Yeah,
we shortchange the children, and we shortchange ourselves as we get older because we still have that inner child
in effect,
with us.
Look at the teacher that wanted to teach that dogmatic thing. Well, the kids wanted something out of the box, something new, right? Wanted something new, and this is the child, this is the inner child. You know, it's not just connecting. So there are two aspects here, because then when we're working with the sounds with the Tibetan bowls, this is part of the work that I do when we work is working first with sound, but.
The inner child.
The inner child. So it's not. So there are several aspects, right? So there is the connection to our inner child, but then there is also the expression of the inner child. So connecting to the inner child is okay, but it's not enough because we want to express it, and expressing coming through the throat, you know, and the throat chakra is many times number one blocked. if there are any blockages, usually it is throat chakra, because it's there is some other aspect that is not being represented, that is not spoken, it is not expressed. For example, so
it's like a short circuit, so to speak.
No, it's a short circuit. I call it a spiritual traffic jam. You know, it's a spiritual traffic jam, right. Because there is, and then when I work with the ball, if there is a blockage somewhere, then the energy won't transfer, and the body will tell me what's going on. But that's
fantastic.
That's part of the you went through that.
Oh, it's fantastic.
That's part of the how through the physical we are moving spiritual items. How through the physical we're getting spiritual. It could be by speech, it could be by sound. Speech is also sound, abracadabra. But here's an interesting thing about religion, dogmatic crap, and all this thing.
How do you really feel?
Well, listen, you know my story, but maybe they don't know.
Yes.
But exactly. but the whole thing is the word sin. Mm. The word sin. Interesting. The word sin in English is you've sinned, and usually it's connotated to something negative. You've done something wrong, you've sinned, you come and confess to somebody who is there to as in the role of removing your sins and allowing you to be atoned. But really in Hebrew, chet, the word chet comes from the word lehachti, to miss the target. And this is what happens. This is really what it is. The Messiah, I don't believe, is somebody in wings and beard. Messiah is our higher consciousness. The Messiah coming into messianic times is being in times where we are understanding in the level and in the capacity that we haven't before, and it is a grandeur expression of the divine, and we understand that, and we can talk about this in a way that is not infringing on anybody's rights, that is not here to offend anybody, and definitely not judge. There is only love and acceptance and truth has no emotions. And so when we are, so the word miss, meaning, oops, hello, darling.
Make a wish.
It's a mosquito.
Oh, but don't make a wish.
Mosquito. Mr. Mosquito, bring me a wish.
Well, maybe that was a message.
Maybe it was a message. I was like, maybe it was a message. Hey, you know. And so the word sin is really to miss, and to miss a target. And why do miss a target? Because there is a cause and effect. We do something, you know, maybe we missed something in our understanding. Maybe we miss, come back and to do that. Or even in this lifetime, how great it is when for example, what you share with everybody that you've had a revelation about and understanding about. You know how great it is to understand something when you're still when you're conscious.
Well, you are, instead of being asleep, what is being conscious and asleep? You brought up morality, which I think, or cause and effect. For me, morality, that's another word, another word. Morality is man-made. So there is no cause and effect. However,
oh, that's interesting. Wait. Say it again.
Morality is man-made. Therefore, there is no cause and effect. However, spirituality, like I said, a state of being, God, love, whatever your words are, universe, whatever your words are, always has cause and effect because it is in the essence of God.
Okay, but I didn't say that, but morality has nothing to do with cause and effect.
That's right. It has no cause.
No, I didn't say so, did I?
No, you didn't.
No, I didn't.
I'm just saying.
Roll the tape.
I'm building upon what you say.
Ah, okay.
So I'm agreeing with you. I'm building upon it.
Okay.
So yeah, when you think about it, morality, again, the dogma, the if you do
no, but
this,
you brought you. It's interesting that you brought up more because the contrast of because this is how many times we live. Mm-hmm. No, you're right. Morality. We're seeing as morality. We're replacing cause and effect with morality. We're saying, oh, this is moral, this is not moral.
That ties in with sin.
That ties in with sin.
That's why I'm bringing it up.
Took me a little moment.
This is where I'm saying, if you think about that.
No, it's right. You're absolutely right.
There's nothing wrong with the religion. We have, there's beautiful, you know, aspects to it and, traditions. Oh,
tradition.
And ritualistics that are just so heartfelt and fun, but I'm bridging upon what you said.
No, this is great. This is great. No, because many times we live and we replace the cause and effect with morality. You didn't do this, God is punishing you. You didn't do this. And this is how I, you know, this is how I grew up. You didn't do this, God is punishing you. You didn't do this, God will punish you.
Yeah.
If you don't do this, God will punish.
When I was little, went to the grocery store, remember they'd have those Brock aisles at the Kroger in Texas?
Oh, yeah,
Kroger?
No.
Or we had Piggly Wiggly.
Piggly Wiggly, I remember. Remember. Piggly Wiggly.
So I was like around 6 or 7 or 8 or 9, around that area. And I kind of, this is the intuition, just like giving the number. I knew something was kind of funny. They had the broccoli and it was a butterscotch and I wanted it, but I'm like, am I supposed to take it or is it stealing? I didn't know the word stealing.
But you took it.
I took it and I choked on it. My mom goes, see, God was punishing you. And I was, I've never touched another one.
You know, but here's the thing. You know, when I say that when we want to create a reality, and many times, what do we get? What we don't want. You say, I don't want this to happen. I hope this will not happen. I just want that. Boom, this happens.
Oh,
why?
Oh my gosh.
Because I put the energy there. So the whole thing with your candy, I'm going to be punished. I'm going to choke on it. You choked on it. It's just like the time where I told you.
I didn't know I was going to choke on it.
No, but you were, but your dogma.
That, yes.
We don't need to know about this.
It was stealing. No, so something bad had to happen.
But here's the thing. You thought it was stealing. What did you do? You invited the energy in. You are like, consumed in it, and you judged yourself. Mm-hmm. And you judged yourself, and you got the punishment. But it doesn't matter. But you judge yourself.
Yeah.
Like if your mom tells you something today, you will just like, all right, mom, I love you. And then you do what you want, right? So, but at that time, no. Yeah. At that time, no. So you believed it. You believed that you'll be punished. Hopefully, I'll do it. Hopefully, it'll go away. Hopefully, I won't do it again.
I stuck to a clean life, right? So to speak.
What?
I did eat another butterscotch later on, but I bit it because I was so afraid I was going to choke.
You remember? I was telling you that story when I was I just moved to Boston. It was like 2000 or something, and I learned how to rollerblade.
Mm.
Right?
How perfect with your hair. And
oh man, I could see in Boston, on the Boston River, on the Charles River,
on
the Charles River, going like this, you know, and I didn't get it at that time that you have to push with your back leg in order to move rather than to do with your front leg. Doesn't matter. So, but when was I rollerblading the best? When I wasn't thinking, when I was just enjoying the wind.
Yep.
It's like, because I released my mind of thinking about that, and I was able to do that. But then I saw this girl standing. There's always a woman involved, right? I was this girl standing at the corner somewhere, like 50 feet or 100 feet or whatever that was there, 100 yards, 20. And I was like, oh my God, I just hope I don't fall at her knees.
You said that in your mind.
I said it in my mind.
Okay.
And I was like, oh man, that'll be embarrassment if I do fall on her knees.
Embarrass.
Embarrassing. Embarrassing. I'll be embarrassing.
So, oh God, I love this story. Go ahead.
Now the thing is that there was a curve, right? And all the time before a curve, I was like, oh my God, there is a curve. And then I would follow the curve. And guess what happened? I fell at her knees. Luckily, it was a sand. I fell on the gravel. So I saw I'm falling. And I fell on her knees, right in front of her. And she's standing here and right in front of her. And she's looking at me. I don't know if she was wanting to laugh or to scream or whatever, but I was like, I'm sorry, I didn't bring the ring.
Perfect. You know? But see, that was a great comeback.
So it was like,
But
it's what I put in my head that is happening.
Yeah.
You know, and imagine this day that where you start and everybody is like yelling at you and this and the hair gets in your face. And then the cop gives you a ticket and then you have a flat tire, you know, this is all a big ball of
snow. It's how you see. I always tell people, okay, you're in traffic. You already know you're going to be in traffic.
Exactly.
Now you can make it the most miserable traffic experience ever. And oh my God, I'm in traffic. Oh my God, I'm going to be like, oh my God, it's going to be the worst experience. Or how about, I'm going to take this hour and you know what? I'm going to call someone who I haven't spoken to in a while.
Exactly.
Or I'm going to play my music or I'm going to be in the quiet. You know, that's where it's peaceful. And then it's not as long as a ride.
Not just as long, it's not as
tormented.
As tormenting because, right. You know, you're in the traffic jam. You know, you're in the traffic jam. It is what it is, right?
It is what it is. I always feel someone who says it is what it is has been through the shit.
You know.
That's why it. He's been through it.
They've
been through it. You're welcome.
This is great. No. So anyway, the question is how do you feel about, so the two topics I want to kind of recap is like, how do you feel in your costume? What do you connect to in the costume? Because connecting into the costume is your inner child. It's part of like, you know, it's like for me, I want to be this. It's like this hair all the time. Yeah. I had this hair thing.
So I'm like, how do you feel in this right like, now? That's yeah, your intro. Like, when we dress up, it is fun, and we put the makeup on. And why do we always have to do it at Halloween? This is what I tell my kids. You don't have to. If you want to dress up July 1st,
exactly.
Who cares?
Exactly.
And as you get older, I remember I took my friend. I love her. And I said, when's the last time you swung on a swing? I don't know. I wouldn't do it. Let's go swing on a swing.
That's fun.
And we went swing. I'm like, how does it feel? And you don't have to. Why does it have to go away? Because we go through life experiences and we think as we get older, oh, no, that's for children.
Yeah.
No, we are all the same. We are the same children.
Yeah, that's fun.
My son yesterday, I took my friend Virginia. We went to the furniture store. So, and she's very wise, very wise. And many years, many, 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 many years older than me. And I made her, or I didn't make her. I asked her to sit in one of the chairs and pretend she was sleeping. We were watching people. So I took a picture of her. I sent it to my son. He goes, okay, Mom, Benjamin Buttons. Exactly.
Exactly.
Exactly. Oh, why not have fun? It doesn't matter how old you are. You know, let's enjoy life. Let's live it. I love the costumes. Costumes
I love
are fun.
It. I love it. You know, you got me hooked on that again. And I was like, oh, and
trust,
I see you now in HD.
HD.
Oh, now up until now I saw you in SD.
SD.
The standard definition. Now, yeah, now high definition.
All right.
It's like the airbrush on Photoshop, you know? It's like when you do airbrushes on Photoshop, when you see all those models that they're like, they're wrinklessless.
Wrinklessness. I know, that's why even now I'm like, oh, wait, pose.
You know that we're almost up on the hour? Can you imagine that?
This was really fun. And thank you so much who joined and had fun. And any comments you want to make if you watch this later,
anything.
Love to know what your costume is, what your favorite Halloween costume is, like I asked the children, and what your superpower is. Yeah. What is your superpower? What it is.
What is your costume? What do you connect to? What do you connect to in that costume? What part of any costume that you have you connect to? That'll be fun too.
What mask do you wear?
We wear masks every day. We wear masks every day. I mean, literally and figuratively.
Exactly.
Today we do it literally and figuratively. We have this thing that we put on our thing, on our mouth.
Thing that we put on our thing. I don't know what he's putting on his thing. Hello. So this was fun. I could keep going.
Yeah, we can go forever and ever. And you know, and it's really. I think this tent.
I
think we're going to migrate
this
tent, and we will just keep that. Our
are you going to wear the wig every week?
I don't know, you know.
Yeah,
I really like the wig.
That's what I'm saying. We don't have to do it today.
Why do only women have to wear wigs?
They don't have to.
Well, you know, it depends who you ask. If you ask a religious or Judaic person.
Well, this is morality
again.
We're getting back to man-made.
No, I get that. But there are facts. You know, the woman's hair has a very strong energetic power. The woman's hair specifically. You know,
is it equated to fertility and things like that?
Temptation.
I don't have a desire to pull your hair though. It looks good on you though. It looks better on you than me. I was gonna put on, but I didn't.
No, you have a great natural wig.
No, but I like being
brunette.
It's fun to be someone else.
Yeah, you're totally different with a brunette.
Yeah.
Yeah, totally different.
Yeah.
So
anyway.
Thank you guys. Thank you everybody for being here. Thank you for joining. Thank you for the courage to have fun and to enjoy. Have the courage to have fun.
I love that.
That is really at the essence of.
Look what's in the word courage. Our age.
Our age.
What?
Yeah.
See our age. Oh God. Okay.
All right.
Sorry.
See our age. Have fun. See courage to the see our age of having fun.
Yeah.
The fun aging courage having. The courage having
you're
fun
aging.
You're
making me go cuckoo, laka, dizzy. Sharmutas.
Oh. All right.
Have a sharmuta day.
That's our cue. All right. Thank you very much for being here. Abracadabra, create what you speak. Gina Ann, I'm Ilan Azulay. Have a wonderful week. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Okay. Bye, y'all.
So should we leave them this running, like a backstage kind of thing? Like an afterwards running, like it's an after show.
Oh, like the bloopers?
Like bloopers.
The blooper poopers.
The blooper.
Okay, I'll.
Classic 100, your ultimate classic rock station. Come together.
Hi, this is Roger Glover of Deep Purple.
Hey, gang, how you doing? It's Joe Walsh.
Classic 100 on Otolis.com. Download the Otolis app from the Apple or Google Play Store and listen to The Alternate in Classic Rock on Classic 100.
Leadership, the final frontier. These are the voyages of the Starfleet Leadership Academy, its ongoing mission to develop leaders through Star Trek, to boldly go where no podcast has gone before. A leadership development podcast told through the lens of Star Trek, the Starfleet Leadership Academy.
Electric Acid. Electric Acid.